All right, well, welcome everybody. Gunnar is unable to MC today, so I will do my best to provide a reasonable facsimile or pale imitation. I direct your attention to line 88 in the pad. We have a special guest star with us today. James Welton from Coder Dojo is here to tell us about what they've got planned for the summer code party. So James, welcome. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for inviting me on.
Maybe you could start by just telling people a bit about what Coder Dojo is all about.
Yeah, so Coder Dojo is essentially a global movement of setting up coding clubs for young people. It started here in Ireland about 10 months ago, and it's grown now to about 70 dojos. There's about 23 in Ireland, a couple in the States, a couple in mainland Europe, and we opened our first one in Tokyo last week. So basically, I'm just adding to the Etherpad now, just a link to a PDF of slides about it. So essentially, young people come on a weekly basis, and you have a whole bunch of volunteers, so like web developers or web designers, and they do essentially just teach kids how to code. And it's a very particular type of environment, so some kids will come to learn, other kids will come to make friends and show off what they've done or collaborate. And it's kind of difficult to encapsulate in words. So there's some images of sessions in the PDF I just put up there on the Etherpad.
Cool. And I see that you occasionally vomit rainbows.
Yes, I do indeed. It's a condition, very rare.
So we're looking at some of the pictures now. So basically, is the target audience for Coder Dojo like youth? Like, is there a particular age range?
Yeah, so most definitely the ages would be between maybe 7 and 18. And a good way to think of it is like kind of like the Boy Scouts of coding. So there's like a couple of cool things that we have. Like if you look at there, that there's stuff that Dojos have done. There's everything from like HTML to Node, game development, even 3D printers and beyond. And then there's also stuff on like what they do also in addition to learning to code is like learning problem solving skills. It's an environment to ask questions, expose and nurture talent, show off what they've done, get advice and direction and a few other things. We have stuff like Zen, which is kind of an online network of like dojos, which we're kind of building more into a directory and a social network around this. And then there's also Kata, which is a wiki where dojos contribute back their session plans and more. So it kind of spawned off like, you know, I'm 19 years old now, and I started coding when I was about 9 years old, and I attribute like a lot of childhood trauma to like semicolons and C programming. And both my parents were dentists, and there was like nobody there to really help me. And while I wasn't like academic or I wasn't good at sport, like coding was really my thing. So I always wanted like a club like this to kind of go to and make friends and learn more and get help and so on. So that's kind of why I set up Coder Dojo.
And so what has the response been like from kids?
Absolutely insane. Take example our dojo in Dublin. We now have four Coder Dojos in Dublin that go on a weekly basis. But when there was a point when there was only one, we used to take in 90 on a Saturday with three streams of HTML, JavaScript, and Python, and we had a waiting list of 200. And when registration would go out on a Monday, we used to be booked out in under a minute. So it was like we were more popular than Ireland's favorite boy band, Westlife. And it's like it's all free and all volunteer based as well. It's been incredible to see it spread. GitHub hold one in their office on a regular basis. Twitter hold one in their office pretty regularly as well. And there's just a whole bunch of kids who are loving it and really benefiting from it. It's been a pretty awesome thing.
So just looking at your slides, would you describe Coder Dojo as kind of like a fight club for coding?
So that was the original. I probably should have added more context to that. The original premise of where it originally came from was I started in my final year of high school. I started a kind of a secret computer club in my school. And it basically was like fight club with keyboards. And then after that, we went ahead, and out of that came Coder Dojo, which I co-founded with Bill Liao. So I probably should have added more context to that. There's not kids like battling to the death with keyboards.
So we're really excited to have you come on board as partner for the Summer Code Party. Maybe you could tell us a bit about why you're interested in participating. What do you see as kind of the possibility in terms of us working together?
So there's a lot of things. I mean, one of the biggest things, in addition to like Summer Code Party being an awesome thing and wanting to support it, is that it's really important that these young kids who are kind of starting off in coding and learning these languages, that they get exposed to like a lot of very contemporary organizations and technologies in present day. So I mean, you have a lot of kids now who are working with like jQuery and with Git, and maybe stuff that wouldn't be exposed in regular computer science courses. Because I know like here in Ireland, computer science courses can only change by about 4% every year, so a lot of the stuff that they teach is stale. But also introducing kids to Mozilla and getting kids a better idea of what Mozilla does is a pretty important thing. And as I said as well, it's an awesome thing, so we're delighted to be involved.
Cool. And so what have you got planned? What will Coder Dojo be doing this summer as part of the Code Party?
So I think a bunch of different things. So obviously we're going to organize a few code jams and national and probably international competitions as well. We're looking at the Coder Dojo international tournament, which, you know, kind of given the kind of like whole oriental karate feel to Coder Dojo, would be like, you know, instead of sweep the leg, it would be like drop the database or something. But we're looking at a lot more kind of meetups, some competitions, and kind of doing stuff with more of that, with more kind of physical activities of people getting together and such.
Interesting, and I noticed on your site you also have a badges and belts component. Could you tell us a little bit about that?
Yeah, so one of the things that we're looking at in Coder Dojo is badges and belts, and it's been something that we've kind of been slow to implement. Coder Dojo is only about at this point 11 months old, so there's still a lot of stuff that we kind of had in the original vision that we're putting into place, but essentially with belts, we're trying to create like a recognition system that when like, you know, a kid has like, you know, the basics of like web design down or something, that they get their white belt and, you know, they basically can progress to black belt in coding. And a few dojos have gone out and experimented with this, that, you know, one dojo gave like all these kids who had the basics of HTML down a white belt, which was actually a wristband with a USB stick in it. And a few other things, and the idea with badges as well is to recognize different merits in Coder Dojo, whether it's, you know, you build your first web application or, you know, you do the basics of Git, and essentially these different components of badges add up to be a belt. And I've written on the Coder Dojo website, which is coderdojo.com, I've written a page on this about what the thinking is behind it, but there's still like a lot more discussion and a lot of things we need to try out before it's kind of pushed into the framework as such for everybody. But it's definitely something that a lot of kids are very excited about. A lot of mentors are very excited about. A couple of dojos have taken the concept, have tried it themselves, and have been pretty successful. So it's just kind of like getting that all together and figuring out something that works on an international scale.
That sounds great. So just we've got some questions in the Etherpad, which we'll ask you in a second. I just want to make sure that we're clear about what concretely you guys have planned for the summer, just so that we can document it and let people know about it. You mentioned that you're going to be organizing a series of physical events and code jams, plus national and international competitions. Is that about right?
Yep. Okay. Exactly.
And so how can people get involved in those things?
So the best way to get involved would be all our information will be going out through the Coder Dojo mailing list, which is on Google Groups, and on the Coder Dojo Twitter account, which is kind of like it's at Coder Dojo, and that's the kind of the primary source of information. There is a few things on the infrastructure, like adding a better form and doing that to make information more accessible, but like if people follow the Twitter account, then they'll easily follow progress on this, and we'll be posting information on how people can get involved. If people have a coder dojo near them, there's a list of them up on the site. They should really get out, go check it out, and possibly help out. If people are interested in setting something like this up in their area, or at least just like doing one session to see how they get on, well then by all means get in contact. We've written up how to get one off the ground, and love to help and see that. So either getting involved with their local dojo or following us online and kind of keeping track of updates.
That's great. Let's move to questions. The first question in the pad, add your questions underline 125. There's been a bit of a pushback lately, James, to this whole learn to code movement, the idea that everybody and anybody should learn code as a literacy, or as something that's as important as reading or mathematics. What would you say to people who argue that not everybody needs to really know how to code, and that it's not an end in itself?
Yeah, I mean, I think that as simple as it sounds, you know, people should do what they want to do. I mean, it definitely is a very helpful thing in what I've seen. If people can code, and there's definitely a lot of benefits with it. And with Coder Dojo, it wasn't as such like, you know, we're gonna teach the world to code and sing and dance. It was more to have it there as an entry point for young people who are interested in this, or young people who are doing this and wanted to see it. So I think that I think at the end of the day that it's not necessary for everybody. But it should be easily accessible for people that want to do it.
So is your main goal to create new professional coders, or to teach non-professional folks how to code? Would you say?
I think it's there to as an entry point and a support for people who are considering it, doing it as a recreational thing, who just want to learn how to make apps or make games and put them up in the App Store, but also as a starting point to if people want to continue that into a professional career. I mean, in no way should Coder Dojo be seen as like the equivalent to doing maybe a degree in computer science or doing an internship at a large company like Google or some sort of formal training per se, but it's really just a fun activity of people who are interested in this area.
So you referred at one point to Coder Dojo as Boy Scouts for coding. What about Boys and Girl Scouts? I mean, I see from your photos that girls are involved.
Yeah.
I guess, what's the gender balance like? And are you kind of aware of the kind of, when Etherpad used the word brogramming, like is this a kind of fairly like male focused way of presenting and kind of framing code?
Yeah. So on the whole, I should probably should have made a more unisex term than Boy Scouts, but it's a common activity for people to associate. But the gender balance is actually really good. I mean, in a lot of dojos, you'll see easily maybe 60% male and 40% female. There are a good number of dojos that have 50-50. And I think rarely you'd see dojos that would have maybe like maybe 90% male and 10% female, or 80% male or 20% female. So the whole, in relation to how the whole the gender balance in the technology world is at the moment, it's pretty good. With the whole programming thing, it's actually pretty funny. A friend of mine, Rob Spector, he's a developer evangelist for Twilio, and he did a YouTube a talk which became a YouTube video on programming. And when that whole thing blew up, he was pretty worried about his image being associated with that. But to be honest, like a lot of the way that stuff is taught in Coder Dojo is pretty unisex, and it wouldn't be in programmer style. I mean, if kids are starting off, let's take example when people teach like HTML, there's something like Notepad++ up on screen or TextWrangler or something, and mentors will be going through different tags. They'll be asking if when they're doing CSS, they'll ask what should the page color background be. If the general consensus is blue, it's blue. If the general consensus is pink, it's pink. I know most certainly there's been a number of times where Coder Dojos have decided to make that the general consensus on I was teaching a session before, and I was asking what we should theme the web page on, and the general consensus was unicorns, so just rolled with it.
Everybody loves unicorns. Well, thanks so much, James. I guess our last question for you is there anything that we can do, that Mozilla can do by way of next steps to help kind of move the partnership along or collaborate more effectively together this summer?
Yeah. So I mean, most definitely, there's a lot of talk on how people see best practices in teaching, or most definitely what people feel should be parts of curriculum, or just a lot of conversation on that topic, which I think would be very beneficial to have. Also, evangelizing the whole Coder Dojo movement and helping, we've got our wiki is, we love when people contribute session plans or resources or tutorials to that. Up on GitHub, when people do open source projects of things that can help Coder Dojo or examples. So definitely when people contribute in that respect. Or people who want to go ahead and either help out an existing Coder Dojo or go set up a new one. The demand is absolutely frightening, and you have in nearly every dojo I've seen, there's always been a pretty big waiting list. When we first opened in San Francisco, there was just a landslide of applicants. So if people want to go set up a Coder Dojo, or at least commit to doing that first session, it's an absolutely incredible thing, and we'd love to help people do that.
That's great. You mentioned there's a Coder Dojo wiki and GitHub. Could you maybe put those links in the Etherpad?
Yeah, of course. So I'll do that now.
Fantastic. Any final questions for James before we push ahead? Sounds like no. Well, thanks so much, James. So we're gonna document up the notes in the Etherpad as a blog post. And of course, we'll be featuring Coder Dojo events in our new events platform that we're launching next week. And we'll be in touch. So thanks so much.
Thank you guys so much for having me.
Fantastic. And yeah, if people want to continue chatting with James and EtherChat, please, by all means, feel free. What's a good segue into our summer campaign update? Aaron, are you leading us off here?
Hello, yes, I will. And then I guess Ben Simon and Michelle can jump in wherever to add things. So quick update today. We're doing the soft launch of the event site this week, I believe on Thursday. And that again is the website where people are going to log their events, promote their events, that kind of thing. We originally were going to do that and the press release this week, but we've pushed the press release back to next Tuesday. So that is the sort of firm deadline of the kind of communications outreach. And the idea is that gives us a little bit more time to do a soft launch of the event site, definitely debug it, but then also get our partners to start to build their events in there and seed the content on there. So that's going on this week, and then next Tuesday, we'll do a press release, an email, a Mozilla blog post, et cetera. Just like Matt has a link there to the current version of the press release, and also some notes here about that communications release will also be the sort of push of webmaker.org and Mozilla.org/webmaker and the new branding stuff. So it'll be kind of all one big push next week around the summer campaign and all of our new branding. Just a quick reminder that, again, the weekend of code is June 23rd to 24th, so that is the date that we're really all working towards. And, again, the reason that we're pushing out the press release next week, a month before, is that we really want to generate a bunch of excitement and get a bunch of people planning and signing up for events in that month before the weekend of code. So all of that is underway. Got a bunch of new partners, kind of blowing me away, the amount of the cool people that are signing up for this. GitHub has signed up and most likely will be doing potentially pushing out communication to their network, and then also maybe we might be working with them as kind of a repository for some of the code that people are building. Campus Party Europe, the National Robotics Engineering Center, which do these huge Lego kind of robotics Lego competitions every year. They reach tens of thousands of youth in actually face-to-face events. And so they're going to do a series of events over the summer around kind of x-ray goggles and web making and potentially some robotics oriented projects. So that's super cool. Scribble Live, the city of San Francisco, a bunch of San Francisco organizations. Ben Simon has been a rock star in San Francisco selling. So I don't know, Ben, if you have anything that you want to add to those new partners. Nope. So cool. Yep. So lots of cool stuff coming in still. And there's a question about, is the partner list up to date on the wiki? It's mostly up to date. I just looked at it. There's a few more, like the NREC is not on there. I think eventually what we'd love to do is build that out a little bit more and sort of list what people are doing as well. But it's mostly up to date at that point. And then quickly, learning content. There's a link there on line 183. I think we shared that last week, which is the beta version of the projects that Mozilla is producing. We're working on an additional 4 that are focused around popcorn. And essentially, we'll point people from. They will basically point people to popcorn to do various things. And then there's another 5 projects that will be developed next week at a big event that we have in London. On that note, a quick shout-out for our event in London next week. Again, this is an on-ramp to the summer campaign. The idea is we're bringing people together to build learning projects that will work on top of WebPageMaker. And there's a link there to the Eventbrite. So if you're going to be in London, please join us. And also, if you know people, especially developers or designers in the London, greater London area, please send that along to them. And then we're doing beta testing right now, and that's of both the kitchen table event design as well as the learning content, the projects. And so we're doing that until through the end of next week. So if you guys have some time, please check out that link on 191 and do some beta testing as well. There's a call right after this call, so if you guys have questions or want to dive in more, it'll be on this number from noon Eastern time to 1. So join us there if you'd like some more information.
Cool. Thanks, Erin. Anybody got questions about new partners or beta webmaker projects or the London event or beta testing in general? Michelle, how's the beta testing ask going so far? We kind of put the word out last week. Are we getting take-up?
I think it's harder to tell how many people are doing it this round because we have given them more of a time frame, and people are also able to do things individually and not just at kitchen table events. I've heard a feedback from a few people so far, but I'd like to make a push again, and if there's anyone else that if people recommend groups to contact about beta testing, that would also be really welcome because at this phase, it's harder to tell how many people have been trying this stuff out.
Okay. Any other questions or comments? I see a link in line 194. The Popcorn Story Camp is getting awesome. I don't know, Jacob, if you want to, or anyone from the Popcorn team wants to elaborate. Is Jacob on the call? It's cool. Actually, I'm just looking at the itinerary. Are these speakers like Damian Kulash from OKGo and Cory Doctorow, are these confirmed at this point?
Looks like yes, according to Ben in the chat.
Oh, wow. So that's bloggable, tweetable? I mean, there's some pretty big names here. It'd be nice to be able to start sharing this more widely. So anyways, I guess we should just follow up. But maybe just let us know if this is all bloggable, tweetable at this point. Very impressive. Cool. Any final questions about summer campaign before we push ahead?
Hello? Hello.
Hello.
Sorry, wrong number. I think Matt, we need to just do like a few more emails to make sure that they know exactly what they're doing so that they don't run away.
Okay.
So don't tweet just quite yet, but we will work to do that this week. And I think we should actually make sure we kind of circle back and make sure that when you guys send out your press announcement that they can be included. But yeah, everyone there is confirmed. So yeah, let's make sure we find a little bit of time to meet today. And I just also wanted to mention to Aaron that I'm not sure if you're aware, but the Popcorn Maker is under like pretty rapid change right now. So I just wouldn't want you guys to write any kitchen tables that had specific activities, and then we moved a button here or there. So we should probably have a little bit of time to chat about that as well, because I know that, for instance, even the current one is like slightly outdated with the instructions, and since the bar is meant to be really low for those activities, just don't want to mess that up. And
cool.
I wanted to give some props to Laura, because Laura has been doing amazing work on all this stuff and all the graphics and just the way that this is all coming together. Laura and Jacob have been doing an amazing job. So, and the Pop Squad, Chris, are you going to talk about that at all? It looked so fun.
Pop Squad. Chris, do you want to talk about Pop Squad? There's an adorable picture of them on the wiki. Sounds like Chris is trapped under a heavy object of some kind. Cool. All right. Well, so Brett, we'll dig into the specifics of like the communications plan in the follow-up summer campaign call.
Sure, yeah. If Jacob is interested to join, I can join that, or Ben can join that.
Okay, very cool. Awesome. Well, let's push ahead to some new messaging from the Web Page Maker team. Michelle Levesque, do you want to take us through this?
Sure.
You want to get closer to the mic?
There's a link there to an Etherpad where we're working on some copy for the Web Page Maker, the sort of site around the tool. So the, you know, about the tool page, the front page, frequently asked questions, project page, et cetera. Currently it's sort of in draft format, so take a look, kind of glance through it. If you know you're left with any huge questions, it would be awesome to have them added to the frequently asked questions list, or you know, if you think some change in the copy would help clarify, please feel free to do so.
And Michelle, what would you say is the most frequently asked question you guys get so far?
When is it going to work?
That's a good answer. Cool. And do people have questions about like who owns their content or privacy or that kind of stuff?
I think that those of us who understand these issues have those questions. So far, I don't think any of the people who we've put this in front of have actually asked that question yet. So it'll definitely go into the frequently asked questions because, you know, we'll have a wider audience. But I don't think that it's something that novices know enough to even consider at this point.
And so some questions and feedback coming in through the Etherpad. Why should I use WebPageMaker? Why not just use Tumblr or WordPress?
Yeah, so I've been trying to brainstorm what a good frequently asked question about that is, and I think that there's a few different things. One is that a lot of the tools like Tumblr and WordPress kind of limit what you can do, so you're stuck with their templates and things like that. Or if you are not stuck with their templates and they let you just edit HTML on your own, folks find that step really difficult. When we talked to the Tumblr folks, they were saying that their number one feature request was, how do I edit my template? And their answer is, you click on the Edit HTML page, but then people don't know what to do with that. It's hard to figure out what is it going to look like, how do I change things, how do I make the color different. And so it really is an easier step towards editing HTML. It makes it easy. It makes it sort of like a one-click thing. The other part that I would say to this is that we're not just writing an app that is going to sort of destroy all these other online editor apps out there. A lot of the parts to WebPageMaker are JavaScript libraries that we're going to be encouraging all the other editors out there to use so that we can improve the ecosystem of online editors out there. So if Tumblr wants to use our spell check suggestion kind of system, they can do so. But I think that we're trying to raise the bar of online editors out there, and we would be delighted if other folks rose to that challenge.
That's a great answer. What are we calling this thing? We're moving away from WebPageMaker, right?
I'm going to defer to Ryan.
We're moving away from WebPageMaker because somebody else is using WebPageMaker. So trying to come up with a different name for it that may, in fact, not be so literal as well. So the folks here for the work week did some brainstorming yesterday, and we'll take another run at it tonight and try and lock it down this week.
Cool. Other questions?
So genius, off angle, creative, interesting ideas are welcome. So if you have any, feel free to drop them in.
Cool. Other questions or comments on the messaging? I mean, is it clear? Does it sort of say what it is? Does it make you want to use it? I guess we'll just leave it with folks, and they can just suggest edits directly to the pad.
Yep.
Sounds good. Awesome. Thanks, Michelle. Well, that actually takes us to the end of the verbal updates. We'll probably wrap up a bit early today. I know some folks over the past week were really struggling with Etherpad issues for their community calls. So I don't know, maybe we can just follow up with that offline. But I know a conversation started in IRC that Etherpad is becoming increasingly kind of fragile and broken for some of our programs who are trying to run their community calls on them. So I just wanted to kind of raise that. We feel your pain, and I'm just hoping that the projects can kind of learn from each other and best practices there. I don't know if there's any other kind of final items or updates before we wrap up. I'm going to have a look at the calendar. Alina, do you want to talk about Programma 2012 on May 19th? Sounds like it's at CityLab in Barcelona. There's a link in line 18 of the Etherpad calendar for those who are interested. And beyond that, of course, there's Nesta in London. So in next week's Mozilla All Hands meeting, we'll be talking about Summer Code Party. And I'd encourage folks to add any suggested guest speakers, particularly around partners for the summer campaign, if you could just add them to the pad that's linked in line 250. And I guess that's about it. Oh, Alina is trying to unmute.
Yeah.
Star 7, Alina. Hey, you were there.
Hey. Yes, I'm here. So, yes, this Saturday I will give a presentation. We will have a one-hour session at Programma 2012. It's an annual conference for public school teachers and instructors from Catalonia, organized by CityLab and the Department of Education. So, they invited me this year to talk about the WebMaker and actually the it's a huge interest here on open badges and Hackathaurus. So right now I'm still working on a presentation, but I will, once I will finish, I will share it for feedback.
That's great. Anything that this group can do to help out?
Well, actually, no. I'm just looking for various materials. But well, will be interesting to see to hear more about the previous instructors conference, because we organized in the past some events for teachers here, but this one it's very different. So I don't know if there is any information about how the sessions in Boston and Toronto went. That would help.
Cool. If you want to email me, nlevesque@mozillafoundation.org, I can start of that information.
Okay, thanks.
Cool. All right, well, thanks, Lena. Thanks, everybody, for participating in today's call. And we will return these 20 minutes of your life to you. Thanks, everybody. Talk to you all next week. And I guess we'll just drop off and dial back in the same line for the summer campaign call. Bye, everybody.
Thank you. Please stand by.